Tengok 11:55 line buat hal. Oh, frust. Ya, kalau dapat masuk awal-awal lah, saya tak larat nak tekan nasib admit-admit je, walaupun saya dah tekan set auto-admit. Itulah. Bila saya buka PowerPoint slide dekat laptop ni, saya tak boleh nak buat auto-admit. Saya terpaksa tekan secara manual guna handphone. Okay, now we look at example 6. Now calculate the net electrostatic force on charge Q1. We have such a system. We have Q1 over here with negative charge, negative 86 microcoulomb, Q3 plus 65 microcoulomb over here, and Q2 plus 50 microcoulomb over here. Now we need to calculate the net electrostatic force on charge Q1. We have charge Q1 over here. Now, so we have multiple body problem. We have three charges. So we need to take a look one by one. So always look at the question. The question asks to focus on charge Q1. And charge Q1, it needs to interact with charge Q3 and charge Q2. So we need to focus one by one. Forget about Q2 first, for example. Forget about Q2. Just take into consideration charge Q3 and charge Q1. Q1 is negative, Q3 is positive. And charge Q1 will be attracted to charge Q3 in that direction, in this direction. Yeah. Lag. Okay, so we have F13, the attractive force experienced by charge 1 due to charge 3. We have this F13. Okay, now forget about Q3, look at Q2 and Q1. Q2 is positive, Q1 is negative. So charge Q1 will be attracted to the left. And we have one F12, attractive force experienced by charge 1 due to charge 2. So how do we add them together? The F13 and F12, they are vector quantity. So we need to add them using vector principles. And how do we do that? F12 is easy because it is already situated, located at the x-axis, but F13 is quite complicated because it is not exactly on the x or y-axis. So we need to resolve the F13 into F13x and F13y. So we do like this. Okay, we have F13y upward, direction is upward, so it is going to be positive, and we have what F13x to the left. This will be negative. Reconstruct the x and y component becomes a triangle. And as you can see, if this one is 30 degrees, automatically we know that this is 30 degrees because it is zigzag. Reconstruct. Okay. Isolate this triangle if possible. So we have F13 over here, F13x over here, and F13y over here. And this is 30 degrees. Now, we I don't like to memorize. If we use sign, will it going to be fx or fy? I don't like to memorize, but I always do it like this. I try and error. 30 degrees over here. How about cos 30? Cos 30 means it is opposite over adjacent. Opposite pula. Terbalik, itu tangent. Cos 30 is adjacent over hypotenuse. Cos 30 is adjacent over hypotenuse. So cos 30 is F13x divided by F13. Rearrange the equation, you will get the F13x will be using equals to F13 cos 30. If F13x use cos 30, then automatically F13y use the sine 30. So we have the formula over here. Now we need to solve it one by one. First and foremost, we need to calculate the F13 and F12. We need to calculate this one first. Okay, now look at the next slide. So F13, simply use the first formula that we have discussed on Monday. F equals to K, this is K, the value of K, it's 8.9875 times to 10 to the power of 9 newton meter square over Coulomb square. This is modulus Q1, modulus, do not forget modulus. If you forget about the modulus, you put negative 86 microcoulomb, then your answer will be wrong. This is modulus charge 3, This is the distance between charge 1 and charge 3. Charge 1 and charge 3. This is the distance. 60 centimeter convert into meter. 0.6 meter. Then you will get 140 newton for F13. F13 we got 140 newton. Then we could resolve it into the X component and Y component. Move along to F12, straightforward. This is K, this is Q1, this is Q2, this is distance between charge 1 and charge 2. You got 143 newton. Now, if you are comfortable with the table, you can make the table to resolve the X and Y component. So we have F13, we could resolve into X component. Now this you need to be very careful. You need always to look again at the diagram that you have drawn. F13x, the direction is to the left. Do not forget about the negative sign. Whenever you see it is going to the left, automatically F13x put negative sign and add the formula that you have derived just now. You have derived this formula, right? So if it is negative, if it is going to the left for the X component, put negative. F13 cos 30. So you will get finally negative 121.24 newton to the left. Okay, F13 is to the left. How about F13y? Upward, automatically you put positive. Okay, F13y, you got the equation just now. Okay, use a calculator, you got 70 newton upward. How about F12? F12 is easy because it is already on the x-axis over here. Okay, this is F12. Calculate it. Okay, you have calculated F12, but do not forget, look at the direction. The direction is to the left. Put negative sign. If you want to put negative sign over here, it's also okay. No problem. It's you are allowed to put negative sign over here as well. Okay. So how about F12y? No y component for F12 because F12 is exactly on the x-axis. Now, next, you need to sum up the all the x component and all the y component. Okay, so F1x equals to F13x plus F12x. Okay, ni F13x plus F12x. Negative 121.24 plus negative 143. You got negative 264.24 and F1y equals to F13y plus F12y, you got 70 plus 0, you got 70 newton. So the net force, okay, is F1 equals to square root of F1x square plus F1y square. Okay, ambil ni square, tambahkan square root, dapat 273.36. And do not forget about direction because we are calculating the vector must have magnitude. The magnitude we have calculated. Oops. We also need to calculate the direction. Use tangent theta. Tangent theta is y component, the summation of y component divided by the summation of x component. Do not forget about the modulus. Okay, we have 70. Put 70. We have negative 264.24 over here. Oh, it lagged. Then you put positive 264.2 because we have modulus. Then we get 0.2649. Arctangent, we got 14.84. Now, don't forget that you need to draw the resultant magnitude and also the direction. How to draw? Remember, we have calculated the Fx and also the Fy. Okay, draw them. Okay, remember we are focusing on charge Q1 tadi. The force experienced by, the forces experienced by charge Q1. So this is the resultant. We have the resultant in X component is negative 264.24. That is the direction. This is the resultant force in the X-axis. And this is the resultant force in Y-axis. 70 newton. This is how we draw. And this is the resultant force, the combination of the Fy and also the Fx. This is the combination. Now we have the triangle already. Okay, these are the calculated value. We have Fy 70 newton, Fx negative 264.24, the resultant force is 273.36, and we have calculated the angle. Now we have two options. Let me jot down for a while. We have two options. We have this one A, and we have this one B. Which one is our angle? Nah, ha. Always refer to the formula again. We always use tangent theta equals to modulus of Fy divided by the modulus of Fx. Now, we have calculated our theta is just now 12 point something. Now, which theta are we going to choose? A or B? If we try to choose A, put A in the theta. Tangent A equals to F equals to opposite divided by adjacent. If take theta as A, then tangent theta will be opposite. This is the opposite. Let me there's a pointer, yes. Now this is the opposite. The opposite is Fx. The adjacent is Fy. So the formula will be wrong. Tangent A equals to Fx divided by Fy. But the formula, the correct formula is tangent should be Fy divided by Fx. So therefore, A is not the correct theta. Instead, let's try B. Tangent B, opposite is Fy, adjacent is Fx. So this fit the formula. So that's why we choose B as our tangent, as our theta, which is 14.85 and not A. This is how we determine the angle of the resultant force. Okay, so move along to exercise 3. I'm not going to explain how can we solve the exercise 3, but I have prepared the video. It's about 23 minutes long. So your task is to study exercise 3 at your own time. This is self-paced learning. Study using the video that I have provided. Make sure the answer is the same. 38.92 Newton and 30 degrees. Okay. I have listed how many videos? 12 videos for the solution of the exercises. We have 12 exercises for the chapter. So hope you can watch the video at your own time. Now, example 7. A 4 microcoulomb charge is located 6 cm from an 8 microcoulomb charge. Okay, we have 4 Q1 positive and Q2 positive. They are separated 0.06 meter away. At what point a line joining the two charges will the resultant force be zero? Oh, soalan ni tak straightforward lah. Dia guna, kita bukan belajar bahasa Inggeris pun, kita belajar teknikal kan. Okay, anyway, if you are facing this kind of question, it means that there will be another test charge. Test charge is always positive and the magnitude is always negligible. We will not consider the magnitude, but test charge is the charge that we put in between these two charges. And the magnitude always positive with unknown magnitude. Okay. Now, it means that whenever we put positive charge in between this Q1 and Q2, okay, this test charge will experience repulsive force. Okay. For example, we have F32. Repulsive force experienced by charge 3 due to charge 2. And we have F31, repulsive force experienced by charge 3 due to charge 1. And the distance between this charge 3 and charge 1 and charge 3 and charge 2 is unknown. So the question is, at what point does the test charge will become static? There will be at certain point where the F32 equals to F31. When F32 equals to F31, the test charge cannot move because the forces acting on test charge will be zero. The net force acting on test charge Q3 will be zero. Means that F32 equals to F31. So we are going to determine the distance over here. Distance charge Q3 from Q1 or the distance of charge Q3 to charge Q2. You need to determine the distance. Either one. We could determine both or either one also acceptable. Now, so this is how it works. F31 equals to F32. Okay, this is the requirement for the charge Q3 to become static. So derive, F31 is the formula KQ3 times Q1. I forgot to put modulus. Don't forget to put modulus. Forgot to put modulus over here. Divided by R31 square. Same goes for R32. We have KQ3 Q2 over R32 square. We could cancel K left at the left and at the right. And also Q3, we have two Q3s. Okay, Q3 on the left cancelled by the Q3 on the right. So we have Q1 over R31 square and Q2 over R32 square. We could rearrange the equation becomes Q1 over Q2 equals to R31 square over R32 square. Okay, yang ni Q2 ni turun ke bawah sini. Yang R31 ni dia akan naik ke atas sini. It swap places. Okay, the swap places. So now Q1 the value is 4 microcoulomb. Ada tulis kat sini. 4 microcoulomb. Q2 is 8 microcoulomb. R31 square and R32 square. Do we know the distance between the Q1 and Q3 and Q3 with Q2? No, we don't have, but we could assume that okay, we have the full distance between the Q1 and Q2. It is 0.06 meter. And the distance between the Q1 and Q3, we could write as X. So if this one is X, therefore the distance between Q3 and Q2 will be 0.06 minus X. And this X, we substitute in the equation. R31 equals to X square. R31 equals to square. R31 equals to X. So insert the formula, we become X square. How about R32? R32, the distance between the charge 3 and charge 2, it is 0.06 minus X. Insert into the equation over here, we got 0.06 meter minus X square. Okay, expand the equation. And this one, microcoulomb, cancel out with microcoulomb. We have 4 over 8. We have 1 over 2. So we have expanded the equation. Okay, rearrange the equation. We got quadratic equation. It's x squared plus 0.12x minus 3.6 times 10 to the power of negative 3 equals to 0. Now you could easily use your calculator to calculate the solution for this quadratic equation. Use your calculator. Let me check my calculator first. For those who don't know how to use the quadratic equation, always look at the mode over here. So for my case, I click mode. Okay. Keep on pressing the mode until you could see the equation. Okay, for my case, the equation is 1. I click 1. So it will show you unknown. Do not choose unknown. Click next. Click next button. You will see degree. Click number 2. Okay, now insert A. A in this equation is 1. Okay, because we have 1 X square. Okay, 1. Then click equals. It asks for B. B is 0.12X. So B is 0.12. Click equals. It asks for C. C is negative 3.6 times 10 to the power of negative 3. This is C. Click equals. And you have X1 equals to 0.025. And you click equal again, you got negative 0.14448. It is equals to negative 0.15 meter. So we choose the positive one. So the X over here equals to 0.0025 meter. This is the distance of Q3 with Q1. Automatically, we could calculate the distance of Q3 and Q2. 0.06 minus 0.025. Dapat berapa? Kirakanlah, ya. Berapa dapat jawapan, Mal?
Yes, sir.
Eh, apa bunyi lagu tu?
Ah, sorry,
okay. Nah, yang ni 0.025. Therefore, yang ni 0.06 minus 0.025 we got over here is 0.035. Ah, this is how we solve the example 7. Okay. Oh, leg throat lah. Now, look at exercise 4.
Sir.
Mm-hmm.
Saya tanya.
Yes.
Is it possible kalau questions bagi opposite, I mean charge yang berbeza, positive and negative, and then dia minta dia minta satu point where the test charge akan equal to zero, akan stay static.
Macam mana kita ada charge yang berbeza nilai? Berapa charge? Yeah,
contoh Q1 is positive and Q2 is negative.
Dalam contohnya, kalau Q1 itu adalah?
Positive.
Positive, okay.
And then Q2 is negative. Possible.
Q2 is negative. Okay, test charge adalah positive. Okay, so dia akan, yang ni dia akan tertolak sana, dia akan tarik sana. Ha. Yang tu tak dapat rasanya sebab dua-dua tarik ke kanan.
Kan, dia akan back pada question atas semula kan ni exercise.
Yes.
Alright.
Yes. Alright. Okay, exercise 4. Now, two charged particles are placed as shown in figure. Okay, so we have two charged particles, both are positively charged. Q1 and Q2. Okay, Q1 is 0.15 microcoulomb. It's located at the origin. Let's say we have a... let's say we have a Cartesian coordinate like this. This charge Q1 is located at the origin. Maksudnya, the coordinate is 0, 0. The coordinate of charge Q1. Right. What else? And charge Q2 0.35 microcoulomb is located on the positive x-axis at x equals to 0.4 meter. So the Cartesian coordinate for x2, so for Q2 is 0.40. Okay. Let's see where it goes. Where should a third charge Q3 be placed to be at equilibrium point? Again, test charge. Aha. Oh, this is exercise. Exercise. Exercise ginilah. Alright. This exercise 4 is similar to example, the previous example. Example 7. Quite similar. So your task again, try to do it on your at your own time and refer to the video that I have posted, the URL which I have posted in the WhatsApp group. Yeah. So I will not show how to solve the exercise in this class, but I will guide you using the examples only. So the exercises, you have to do it on your own, like that. All right. Now, so we have finished the first part of the chapter 7, which is the electrostatic forces. Then we move on to the electric field. So let's see the definition of electric field first. So the electric field is the electrostatic force on a small charge divided by the test charge value. So it is the force divided by the charge of a test charge. For example, so we have charge Q1 and we have charge Q2. Kenapa Hidayah? Maaf, saya tak dapat baca. Saya dapat sempat baca hu-hu-hu je. Kenapa tu? Oh, Hidayah. Hidayah, okay.
Okay.
Saya sempat baca hu-hu-hu je. Kenapa hu-hu-hu?
Oh, tak. Tengok bab ni macam susah je.
Susah ke?
Ya. Yeah.
Takpelah, slow-slow eh. Okay, tak apa, kita tengok slow-slow. Kalau saya terlaju sangat, beritahulah. Sir, laju sangat, slow sikit. Saya slow sikit lah. Okay. Now, of course, if we have charge Q1 over here, whenever we try to put a test charge nearby the charge Q1, okay, test charge always positive. Whenever we talk about F test charge, it is always positive. Whenever we put a test charge nearby the charge Q1, let's see the value of charge Q1. Charge Q1 is negative. So if it is negative, it will attracted to the charge Q2 with the force F12. This one we have discussed in the subtopic number one. So now, the electric field for the charge, okay, the electric field over here could be defined as F12 divided by test charge. So F12, we have KQ1 times Q2 divided by R square. Okay, this is F. And the test charge value is put over here, divided by Q. So we cancel out Q, we got the electric field equals to K equals to E equals to KQ1 over R square. So meaning that the electric field for any charge is equals to K times the charge of that charge itself divided by the distance between that charge between the test charge. Okay, so again, we know how to calculate F12 if positive charge comes nearby. Okay, so to calculate the electric field around the charge Q1, we just need to consider the K, which is constant, the charge of the Q1 itself, and the distance between the charge and the point that we are referring to, meaning that from Q1 to Q2. How about the value of charge Q2? Negligible. We don't know, also no problem. Doesn't harm us, as long we know the distance between them. Okay, tengok example lagi senang kot, pun nampak tak apa, eh? So the electric field, the electric field that we calculated can be represented by the field lines. More lines means greater magnitude of the electric field. Lagi banyak line ni, maksudnya kita punya electric field lagi kuat. Ini gambar standard lah. So the electric field, okay, the direction of electric field, direction dah lain sikit tau, bukan left, right, up, down. Kalau if the charge is positive, the direction of electric field is outward. Dia keluar. Outward. If the charge is negative, the direction is inward, towards inside the charge itself. Okay, dia keluar dan juga masuk ke dalam saja. Okay. Okay, ini kalau charge itulah sebenarnya. Okay, if we have static charges, positive and negative, so the charge going out from positive will be bent, and finally it will apa, comes in the negative charge. It follows the rule that negative charge has inward electric field, okay, and positive charge will have outward electric field. So they will becomes like this. Same goes for rod, charge rod. Okay, positive and this is negative. The electric field will be coming out from the positively charged rod and it will come inside the negatively charged rods. Now, let's see example first. Calculate the magnitude and direction of the electric field at point P. This is point P, which is 30 centimeter to the right of point charge Q. This is Q. So whenever the question asks you like this, it means that at point P, there must be a test charge positive. Assume that there is a test charge at point P. So remember, the question asks you to calculate the electric field. The electric field that belongs to charge Q, not the test charge. We don't care about the test charge. We always care about the charge that is been focused in the question. So the E equals to KQ over R square. And Q is modulus. Tak tulis modulus ni. Take note eh. We have modulus. The formula, the first formula that you learn in the first subchapter, we have modulus. Now, the equation in the second subchapter, which is the electric field, also have modulus. Saya terlupa nak letak ni. Always put modulus. That's why we got positive here. The charge is negative, but when we have modulus, the charge become positive. Okay, so K times the charge that we are focusing in the question, divided by the distance between the charge Q and the test charge at point P. So we have the distance 0.3 meter. This is very straightforward question. Calculate correctly, you'll get 3 times 10 to the power 5 Newton per coulomb. Direction, ke mana direction dia? Towards the charge Q. Why towards the charge Q? Because it is negative, negatively charged. The electric field will be towards charge Q. The electric field, the direction of electric field inward towards the charge Q. Kalau positif macam mana? Kalau positif dia keluar. Okay, away from charge Q ataupun outward from charge Q. Okay. Let's see exercise. Exercise ni boleh kot saya nak tunjuk exercise 5. Rasanya exercise 5 ni dia tak apa? Tak complicated. Tapi tak boleh. Saya punya laptop dah hang. Tak boleh nak keluar pun. Ya, saya cuba. Saya cuba. Kalau boleh, bolehlah. Tengok dulu. See? Lambat. Semua okey ke? Dah makan ke? Ke sambil-sambil makan? Senyap je ni.
Belum.
Belum. Guna mana guna?
Tidur.
Azrai. Oh, ada. Pak, slow lah. Tak boleh nak tunjuk.
Ada, doktor.
Ada eh. Bagus. Doktor, value 4K boleh. Siapa tanya tadi eh? Chat tu saya tak dapat tengok sebab laptop saya lag teruk hari ni. Apa soalan Hafiz. Tadi? Hafiz. Apa soalan dia Hafiz? Tak boleh lah, lag teruk lah. Tak boleh tunjuk YouTube lah.
Value untuk K tu boleh pakai 9 atau kena pakai 8.9875?
Okay, kalau dapat pakai 8.9875 kali 10.9. Kalau dapat, tapi katakanlah alamak masa dah suntuk sangat. Hang bedal je lah. 9 kali 10 kuasa 9. Last resort tau. Kalau kalau tak sempat sangat. Tak dapat nak tunjuk YouTube lah. Kali ni saya punya laptop pula lag. Nampak ni. Saya buka full screen pun dia lambat. Jadi exercise 5 ni. Cuba tengok sendiri lah kot eh. Dekat masa lapang sendiri. Dekat hostel. Kalau tak ada masa lapang. Tak tahulah saya. Kena carilah masa lapang untuk try buat exercise 5 ni. Jawapan dah diberikan. Saya dah semak jawapan betul. So make sure kamu cuba buat dulu. And baru rujuk dekat video saya. Nah, exercise 9. Example 9. Example boleh kita bincang. Tak ada masalah. So two point charges are separated by a distance of 10 cm. Two point charges. Saya tukar ni kepada laser pointer dulu. Two point charges are separated by a distance 10 cm. One has charge negative 25 microcoulomb. Okay, ni. We have negative 25 microcoulomb. And another charge is 50 microcoulomb over here. It's Q2. So A. Determine the direction and magnitude of the electric field at point P between the two that is 2 cm from the negative charge. Determine the electric field at point P if we have one test charge over here. Okay. What is the resultant electric field? Now, remember we have two charges. Of course, there will be two electric field clashing at point P. Uh-huh. So how are you going to calculate them? Easy, focus one by one. Forget about Q2 first. We consider Q1. If this is the case, Q1, we have Q1 over here, we have test charge HP, we have the charge value of Q1, we have the distance. Of course, we could calculate E1, KQ1 over R1 square. As simple as that, let's see the solution. Now, okay, we consider, okay, the Q1 first. Of course, Q1 is negative, Q2 is positive. E1, the direction will be towards Q1. Why? Because Q1 is negative. Whenever the charge is negative, the direction of the electric field will be inward, will be towards the center of the charge. How about E2? Why E2 to the left? Because charge Q2 is positive. So the electric field for charge Q2 is outward. Sebab itu the outward mengalir sana, ke arah kiri. E2. So we have E1 and E2. Over here. So we need to sum them up. E1 plus E2. Macam mana nak kira? We calculate one by one. So the total electric field is E equals to, this is E1. E1 is equals to KQ1 over R1 square. And this is E2. Yang ni. E2 is K times Q2 divided by R2 square. So we have similar K, we could factorize them, K keluarkan, we have 8.9875 times 10 to the power of 9 Newton meter square over C square. This is K. How about Q1 over R1 square? This is Q1 over R1 square. Q1 is 25 times 10 to the power of negative 6 Coulomb. Modulus becomes positive. This is the distance between the E1, the point P and Q1. 2 kali 10 kuasa negatif 2 meter square. And this is Q2 divided by R2 square. Okay, kira hati-hati, guna kalkulator. Kira satu-satu. Ini cara cepat yang saya tunjukkan ni. Jangan guna cara cepat. Kira satu-satu, tak ada masalah pun. Kira je. Kira dulu yang ni, guna kira yang ni, baru tambahkan. Pun boleh. Lagi bagus macam tu. Tak bercampur-campur macam ni. Yang saya tunjuk ni adalah shortcut. Sebab apa? Sebab PowerPoint slide saya tak cukup panjang. Nanti bersambung sampai 3 muka surat, kamu bosan pula. Nak tengok slide ni apa, ada 87 pages pun dah nak pitam kan. So the answer is 66.3 times 10 to the power of 8 Newton per coulomb. Okay. This is the total field experienced by the test charge at point P. Direction ke mana? Direction dia ke kiri. Lupa nak tulis kat sini. Direction is towards left ataupun inward to the center of charge Q1. Ataupun outward, away from charge, test charge Q2, from charge Q2 pun boleh. Alright. Question B. If an electron with mass 9.11 times 10 to the power of negative 31 kilogram is placed at P. Aha, kalau ada electron. If we put an electron over here with mass such that, and then released, we put over here, then we release the electron. What will be its initial acceleration? Determine the direction and the magnitude of acceleration. Aha. So remember our kinematic equation. Not kinematic. The force, mass, and acceleration equation. F equals to ma. Okay. So we could calculate a equals to f over m. Yeah, the mass of the electron is given. How about the force? Of course, we just need to consider the electrostatic force, because this is the subatomic particle over here that we are referring is the electron and the positive charges. So we use F, electrostatic force. So F equals to K times Q1 times Q2 divided by R square. But for this case, we could use QE. What are they? Q is the charge of the electron, because we put the electron over here. And E is the electric field, the total electric field that we have calculated in the example 9A just now. So F equals to, okay, how this is how we derive the equation. F, this F, this F, oh selonya, saya tunjuk, pointer saya tunjuk tempat lain ni. Tapi suara saya dah laju ke tempat lain. Okay. F equals to, oh lambatnya pointer tu bergerak. K, Q1, Q2 over R square. Okay. And we could factorize Q1 out. And we have K, Q2 over R square. And therefore, force also will be equals to Q1, charge Q1, times the electric field. So this is how we got F equals to Q times E, where E is the electric field experienced at point P to any charges over here. And Q is the value of charge that we put on the point P. So F we could calculate from Q times E, and M is given from the question, M. The charge of electron, it is constant. Charge of electron is 1.6 times 10 to the power of negative 19 coulomb. The value is negative, but we have modulus becomes positive. How about the E? The E we have calculated in question A just now. Just insert the value. How about M? M is given. M is given. Calculate carefully. You will get 1.1 times 10 to the power of 20 meter per second square. How about the acceleration? Since the net field is directed to the left, the electron will feel a force to the right, negative charge. Boleh faham yang ni? We have calculated the A. Okay, the acceleration over here. Okay, if we put negative charge over here, we put negative charge, this is negative, this is positive. We have electron over here. Electron will move which direction? Negative sini, electron sini, positive sini. Electron will move which direction? Dia akan ke kanan. Always refer to the diagram. Do not straight away, oh positive, must be to the right. Don't be like that, brother. Don't be like that. Always look at the diagram. For chapter 7, it's a special case. You always need to look at the diagram to know the direction of the charges. Okay, this is negative. If you put negative charge over here, of course it will repel. The electron will move towards to the right. This one, positive, even better. The electron still moves to the right. Okay. Next, example 10. We will take 5 at exactly 1 p.m. 1 p.m. we will take 5. Example 10. 48 nanocoulomb point charge is placed on the x-axis at x equals to 4. So this is the origin. This is 4 meter. And charge, apa ni? And a negative 24 nanocoulomb point charge is placed at the y-axis at y equals to negative 6. Okay, this is the origin. This is, distance is negative meter downward. Okay, this is, the distance is 6 meter from the origin. This is charge Q2, negative 24 nanocoulomb. What is the magnitude and direction of electric field at the origin? Here means that we need to calculate the magnitude and direction of the electric field at the origin over here. Tu. Yang ada lambang X-Men tu. Kita kena calculate the magnitude and direction of the electric field at that point. Mm-hmm. So how are we going to do that? Okay, always remember that. Okay. Charge Q1 is positive. Sekejap eh, ada orang ketuk pintu. Sekejap je, sekejap je. Dia kelas, dia kelas. Ah, masuk eh, masuk. Dia masuk eh. Pakai, pakai. Kau ke telefon tadi. Aku tak cam suara kau. Okay, we continue. Alright. Okay, remember this is electric field lah. It's not electrostatic force. Electric field, you need to remember. Okay, charge Q1 is positive. So the direction of the electric field will be out from the charge. Whenever it is out, it's going to the center of the origin. That is E1. Jangan cakap tersilap pula. Eh, ini charge positif. Dekat origin ni test point, test charge adalah charge positif. Kenapa dia menghampiri test charge? Bukan macam tu. Because this is the electric field. Electric field will always look at the charge. If the charge is positive, then electric field will be out from the charge. Meaning E1 is going over there. It's going towards the center of the apa ni? The origin. How about Q2? Q2 is negative. Whenever negative, the electric field will be always inward. Dia masuk ke dalam charge negative. This is E2. So we have E1 and E2. Now we know the direction of E1 and E2. We could calculate easily. Now, E1. So it is exactly on the x-axis. Okay, E1 is exactly on the x-axis. We could write E1 x equals to k times the value of charge of Q1 divided by the distance between the origin and the Q1. Calculate them. You will get negative. Why negative? Because we already put modulus over here. Why negative? Because look at the diagram again. The diagram, E1 is towards to the left. Yes, I know if you hit your calculator, you will get positive 27 Newton per coulomb. But the direction, you need to remember, you need to identify the direction. Direction is to the left, then it is negative 27 Newton per coulomb. Or you could always put 27 Newton per coulomb and you put the direction is to the left. Also can. If you want to put both, also can. Acceptable. Now, how about E2y? E2 is exactly on the y-axis, so we could define it as E2y. E2y equals to k q2 is 24 nanocoulomb. We put modulus, so becomes positive divided by 6 meter, because this is the distance between the origin and the q2 charge. Insert the value. See, E2 is going downward, also negative downward. Okay, clear. So the total field, is ER. Okay, the resultant field equals to square root of E1x square plus E2y square. So we have E1x square, okay, E2y square, dapat 27.65 Newton per coulomb. How about direction? This is the magnitude. Direction, same principle. Tangent theta equals to the component of y, resultant of y divided by resultant of x. Modulus, don't forget about the modulus. And theta, we got 12.52 degrees. Which one is that? So we have E1 and E2 over here. Okay, we have E1 and E2. Okay, reconstruct. Okay, this is our resultant ER. Reconstruct the triangle. So we have E2y, we have ER, we have E1x. Reconstruct again the triangle. This is E2y. So again, we have calculated the value of E2y and E1x. Downward and left. Okay, we have E1X negative 27 Newton Coulomb. E2Y, we have negative 6 Newton Coulomb. Okay, reconstruct, we have such diagram. And theta, we choose this one because we are referring to the tangent theta equals to the y component divided of divided by the x component, opposite over adjacent. So if we choose this one as theta, this one, the one that I'm highlighting now, if this is the theta, this is wrong because it won't fulfill, it won't satisfy the formula of tangent theta equals to opposite over adjacent. So the one that is fulfilling the requirement is this theta. This is 12.52, the one that we have calculated. So this is how you answer the question for exercise number 5. I think we need to take 5, eh? Okay, it's 12:58. We take 5, we continue on 1:05 PM. Okay, rehat dulu. Saya guna Wacom. Yang tunjuk-tunjuk tadi tu kan? Ha, saya guna Wacom ni. Tak ni. Kalau kamu nak buat presentation ke apa, jangan pakai Wacom lah kot. Wacom ni saya beli sebab saya nak main Photoshop. Kalau kamu tak bermain-main dengan Photoshop, tak payah pakai Wacom. Cari device yang apa, touch screen lagi bagus, lagi berbaloi. So siapa-siapa yang nak pakai untuk edit gambar ke apa dan juga untuk buat presentation tulis-tulis contoh-contoh macam ni, pakai Wacom bolehlah. Rehat dulu. Eh, ada 51 orang je. Kita anggaplah yang lagi 6 tu tak ada internet yang okey kan. Saya stop presenting dulu lah. Firdaus? Mana Firdaus?
Ya.
Sihat Firdaus?
Sihat, sihat.
Tengah apa tu? Sambil-sambil makan, sambil-sambil mendengar lagu?
Tak makan lagi.
Ayuh ke?
Kesiannya. Ya, kejap ya.
Wahidah, Wahidah. Di manakah Nurul Wahidah? Makan lepas kelas, doktor. Ya, doktor. Ha, huruf besar tu dia. Marah. Eh, Wahidah, kuis 3 kenapa tak buat, Wahidah? Ada 3 orang tak buat. Wahidah, Nabiha. Seorang lagi lelaki. Yang lelaki siapa eh? Bukan Mael, Mael, eh saya dah buat lah doktor, eh ya ke? Saya check tak ada lah Wahidah. Mic saya problem, tak apa tak apa, nanti saya check dengan Madam Aina. Ada 3 orang tu, Wahidah, Nabiha. Siapa lagi seorang eh? Lelaki, seorang lagi ni. Dia nama-nama 3 orang ni hampir-hampir sama. Tak ada, dia ada ha-ha-ha tu. Ah, ya yeah, Nabiha buat juga lah. Tak apa, nanti check dengan Madam Aina. Mana hilang korang punya markah ni? Okay. Ain Papi Jun siapa eh?
Azrai.
Kalau buat hal, tak tahulah saya. Oh, Ain Papi Jun ni Azrai. Cheng Ping, sihat? Mana Changping ni?
Hai doktor, sihat?
Hai, sihat eh? Bagus. Emilia, macam mana keadaan Emilia? Kawan-kawan, hari tu Emilia ni tak berapa sihat lah kawan-kawan. Tapi dia tak sihat pun dia datang kelas tau. Oh, dia join. Tak syat betul Emilia ni. Apa khabar Emilia? Oh, mana pula Emilia ni? Tengah kena cocok doktor ke? Wah, gelap besar dia. Ha 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 ha. Kat mana tu? Kat ward ke? Mana Emilia ni? Kat rumah. Okey. Kakak macam mana itu? Okey dah. Okey, alhamdulillah. Risau kita eh. Vicky, Vicky lutut macam mana Vicky? Dah boleh main bola belum? Berapa lama kena rehat? Main championship manager je lah Vicky.
7 bulan.
7 bulan eh. Habis jalan okey lah ke pakai tongkat?
Boleh jalan.
Boleh jalan. Okey okey. Habis tu main PS je lah kat rumah eh. Tak boleh main bola.
Ya doktor.
Nak pakai lama lagi kaki tu, rehat betul-betul lah.
Okay.
Okay. Syaril, Syaril. Saya jarang betul lah tegur nama Syaril ni. Pandai dia nyuruk. Mana Syaril? Syaril, oh Syaril. Tak buka mic Syaril. Syaril, oh Syaril. Telefon pejabat saya ni rosak. Orang selalu komplain kata saya tak pernah jawab call. Padahal saya komplain banyak kali dah. Telefon pejabat saya rosak, tak ada orang datang baiki. Dia orang datang baiki pun tak baik-baik juga. Tak tahulah kenapa. Kena sampuan tu agaknya telefon saya ni. Asyikin. Ada dua Asyikin ni. Mana satu? Nurul Asyikin. Bawah ni Nurul Asyikin. Orang yang sama ke orang yang berbeza ni?
Lain doktor.
Ya, yeah, seorang dia. Seorang pakai baju color apa ni? Color oren dia buat macam ni. Seorang lagi gambar apa tu? Gambar pokok kan? Bukan. Tak pernah nampak seorang lagi tu. Yang chicken yang mana satu? Saya selalu sebut chicken tu.
Saya.
Chicken ni, gambar orang pakai apa tu, headband. Itu chicken yang saya sebut. Okay, Syuhada. Ada tak Syuhada?
Ini okay, saya.
Apa khabar Syuhada? I'm Papi Jun, doktor saya nak pergi toilet. Alah, pergilah. Jangan bawa handphone tu pergi toilet, Azrai. Termasuk dalam lubang jamban tu, tak pergi kelas lah setahun. Okey, Syuhada sihat ya? Ya, Mak El.
Alhamdulillah sihat.
Alhamdulillah. Silalah Mak El, silalah pergi ke tandas. Nadia. Nur Ain Nabilah left the room. Ya. Mana Nadia ni yang gambar burung hantu ni? Okey, Nadia ada. Alright. Sihat ya Nadia eh? Okey, dia begini. Kalau ikutkan kementerian apa kementerian KPM bagus sihat alhamdulillah. Doktor dah makan ke belum? Belum, saya belum makan lagi. Lepas kelas lah makan. Kalau ikut ke Kementerian Pendidikan Malaysia ni, pelajar-pelajar akan baliklah ke kampus pada March 2021 nanti. Tapi kita tak tahulah apa yang akan terjadi, sama ada boleh dibenarkan balik ke ataupun tidak. Tapi setakat ni memang perancangan kementerian memang nak pelajar baliklah bulan 3 nanti. Sekarang ni Kementerian Kesihatan pun sedang membuat prosedur lah. Sedang buat prosedur. Sebabnya kalau kita nak berterusan tidak keluar rumah pun tak boleh juga. So prosedur dia ada pelbagai. Prosedur bagaimana kalau dijangkiti, apakah yang akan buat, prosedur pembelian vaksin pun satu hal juga. Vaksin daripada negara mana nak pakai, nak pakai Pfizer ke, nak pakai daripada China ataupun Rusia dan sebagainya. Jadi mereka tengah timbang tara. Jadinya mereka tengah ni lah, hari-hari diorang ada mesyuarat. Kementerian Pendidikan, Kementerian Kesihatan, dua-dua ni benda penting kan. Kalau nak buat PKP macam hari tu pun, kita risau, takut ramai sangat orang jobless. Bila ramai sangat jobless, you know, kacau bilau lah. Macam mana kita nak hidup macam mana kan? Kalau kita nak niaga pun, tak dibenarkan keluar rumah. Macam PKP yang mula-mula itu. Okay? Bila 3 sampai bulan berapa itu. So ramai orang akan stres. Orang yang makan gaji ni, mungkin okey lah kan? Tak terasa, tapi bila orang yang tak makan gaji ni, yang jual online. Jual online pun satu hal kat hidayah. Yang jual makanan macam mana? Tak boleh nak ni kan? Tak boleh nak deliver kan? Satu hal kat tu. Tu kalau ada, saya pun dah berapa lama tak balik kampung ni. Daripada bulan 3, tak balik kampung. Sekarang ni pun tak boleh balik kampung lagi. Sebabnya saya ni staf kerajaan. Staf kerajaan, arahan terkini adalah dilarang untuk pergi ke tempat-tempat zon merah. Kalau kami pergi kat tempat zon merah, kami akan dikenakan tindakan tata tertib. Jadi tak boleh balik kampung lagi saya ni. Alright. Jadinya tengoklah, saya pun ada berbual-bual lah dengan doktor-doktor. Saya berbual baru ni dengan pengarah Hospital Jasin. Menurut dia, KKM lepas ni mungkin yalah, kita nak buat PKP pun tak boleh. Ekonomi teruk nanti. Apa boleh buat lah, mitigation lah. Mereka akan buat mitigation. Yang mana sakit, yang ada simptom, dan diorang akan treat sepertinya lah. Dan jikalau terlalu ramai yang kena, maka mungkin akan dibuat satu SOP barulah, yang mana hanya perlu kuarantin di rumah. Bergantunglah, kalau simptom teruk, memang kena masuk hospital. Mana yang positif COVID-19 tetapi asymptomatic, maksudnya tak ada simptom, tak ada demam, tak ada batuk, tak ada sesama, kuarantin saja di rumah. Sebab untuk pengetahuan kamu, ada 3 staff BMP kena COVID-19 beberapa minggu yang lepas. Jadinya, staff ini tak ada simptom langsung. Mereka setakat ni dimasukkan ke ward lah, tapi cepatlah sembuh, dalam seminggu dah sembuh dah. Tak ada simptom langsung, demam tak ada, batuk tak ada, semua tak ada. Mereka terpaksa buat swab test. Kenapa? Kerana mereka adalah close contact kepada seorang kawan mereka yang positif. Bila kawan mereka positif, mereka close contact, mereka segera pergi dekat pusat kesihatan, buat swab test, positif. Sedangkan mereka tak ada simptom langsung. Jadi kalau dengar daripada berita-berita, berita terkini, dekat UK kata ada strain baru, virus yang telah bermutasi, yang mana keboleh jangkitannya lagi tinggi. Orang ramai bila dengar perkataan keboleh jangkitan tinggi ni akan risau lah, maksudnya lebih mudah untuk kita dijangkiti dengan strain baru virus ni. Tapi bila saya tanya-tanya pakar, mereka kata boleh dijangkiti, tak semestinya kita akan jadi lebih teruk simptom dia. Oh, kita ingat bila dah virus tu senang menjangkit orang, maksud simptom akan lebih teruk lah kan? Kita ingat macam tu, rupa tak. Mungkin kita senang dijangkit, tapi badan kita boleh lawan secara automatik. Tak akan demam, tak akan batuk, tak akan sesama langsung. Boleh jadi. Jadinya dia orang kata tak perlu risau dulu. Mereka memang ada plan lah macam mana nak buat. Kajian-kajian memang non-stop. Sebagaimana kita tahu, virus adalah lebih bahaya daripada bakteria sebab dia mampu bermutasi dengan cepat. Dia mampu menyesuaikan diri. Itulah virus. Begitu dia. Jadi sekarang ni dekat norma baru ni lah. Jadi macam-macam lah, kita belajar secara online, kita apa buat segala benda banyak secara online juga. Lebih memudahkan adalah memudahkan orang nak kahwin. Nah, itu saya cukup setujulah. Sekarang ni, dulu kalau nak kahwin RM30,000, RM20,000 tak lari. Tak lari dek. Saya kahwin dulu pun RM25,000. Itu tahun 2008. RM20,000 tu baru majlis. Belum hantaran lagi. Jadinya dengan ada COVID-19 ni, siapa nak kahwin, kalau dulu, jom kahwin Fidaus, ambil kau terus. Kalau dulu, kalau kita tak nak buat majlis, mak bapak akan cakap apa? Malulah kat jiran, sedara mara kita tak buat majlis kan? Kali ni, tak ada siapa nak persoalkan kalau kita tak buat majlis. Jadi kita dah save 25K lah kat situ. Lagi berguna. Ingat pesan saya, kalau kamu nak kahwin nanti, janganlah buat pinjaman bank. Ramai kawan-kawan saya nak kahwin buat pinjaman bank. Jadi sampai anak dua, anak tiga, pinjaman tak habis-habis bayar lagi. Walaupun setiap bulan sekadar berapa dia orang bayar, dalam 200 setiap bulan. Tapi kalau dah sampai 10-11 tahun, 200 kali 12 kali 10 dah berapa? 20-20 ribu lah kan? Rugi lah. Janganlah. Okay, simpanlah duit tu. Right, tadi ada yang tanya, yang datang zon merah ke kita ni macam mana? Itu pun kerajaan dah ingatkan. Pelbagai kempen dah buat. Kita nak sekat dah tak boleh. Apa yang kita boleh buatlah dekat diri kita sendiri. Macam saya contohnya lah kan. Memang tak patutlah saya buat ni. Adik ipar saya nak datang ke rumah saya nak bawa mak bapak. Okay, mak bapak mertualah. Sebab dah lama tak jumpa kan nak bawa. Memang kerajaan tak ada halangan untuk rentas negeri, tetapi diri kita sendiri ni, kita yang perlu tapis. Kita cakap baik-baik dengan orang-orang, engkau daripada zon merah, kami ni zon oren. Bukan nak kata engkau ni pembawa COVID, tetapi chances untuk kau, untuk orang dekat zon merah, untuk kena COVID lagi tinggi daripada chances orang di zon oren dan juga zon hijau. Saya kata begitu. Saya dah rasa bagaimana 2 minggu kuarantin tu. Itu saya negatif. Kalau saya positif, lagi susah saya nak jalankan tanggungjawab saya. Saya tak boleh ke sana sini, saya kena mengajar tapi tak boleh nak keluar kan. Jadinya begitulah pelbagai benda lah. Kita sendiri yang kena tapis kat rumah. Jadinya kalau ada orang yang berentas juga daripada zon merah, kita tak boleh nak buat apa. Kalau kita kenal dan kita tahu, kita boleh nasihatkan dia. Janganlah merayap. Nak merayap lain tahun boleh tak? Kadang kita heran juga. Kita pergi mana nak beli-beli barang kan. Tengok-tengok, ya Allah, ya Tuhan, kenapalah orang-orang ni semua bersusun penuh. Kalau korang tanya aku kedai makan, saya memang tak pergi kedai makan lah. Orang rumah saya masak je lah. Tak apalah. Biarlah tak makan benda-benda fancy, janji saya jaga saya punya penjarakan sosial. Nak makan benda-benda fancy, lain tahun boleh buat. Tak pun belajar sendiri, cari resepi, belajar sendiri, buat sendiri. Macam-macam dah resepi berjaya dibuat dah. Kalau dulu saya tak reti masak apa rasam, saya sudah terer masak rasam. Tak boleh nak pergi kedai mamak, nak buat macam mana? Nak hilangkan gian, masak sendiri rasam. Contohnya lah. Alright, semua dah ready eh? Sambung, kita dah terlebih masa dah ni. 10 minit. Rasam tu apa? Dia macam sup. Kat Kuantan ni, kedai mamak dia kurang lah. Kalau kat KL ke Selangor ke, memang setiap kedai mamak adakah ada rasam. Kuah sup. Sup herba lah. Cuba lah. Kadang dah terliwa dah apa mulut saya ni. Cuba Google rasam tu yang macam mana Google dia. Dia bagus untuk orang, macam mana? Kalau rasa macam badan sengal-sengal ke ataupun macam nak demam sesama ke, makan rasam. Cepat kamu pulih. Tanya-tanya Vicky. Vicky tahu tak rasam apa? Cuba Google rasam. Okay, kita sambunglah. Mana? Present now. Okay. Sakit pula tengkuk saya ni. Ya, macam sup, Fidaus, macam sup. Okay, exercise 6 pun tak keluar lagi . Internet slow yang amat. Laser pointer, saya tukar color pula lah. Color apa? Hijau. Ya, kali ni. Exercise 6 sama . Cuba buat exercise 6 ni. Okay, buat exercise 6, buat sendiri, kemudian rujuk jawapan dekat saya punya YouTube video. Saya ada bagi link dah dekat WhatsApp group dah. Okay. Okay, kita dah tamat bahagian 2 chapter 7, iaitu electric field. Sekarang kita nak tengok electric flux pula. Dia berkait tau. Yang pertama tadi, electric force. Electric force berkait dengan electric field. Electric field pula berkait dengan electric flux. Apa benda electric flux tu? So the electric flux and Gauss law. Okay, katakanlah gambar ni sebenarnya menggambarkan satu wayar. Okay, this diagram actually depicted the cross-sectional area of a current-carrying wire. Inside this one, inside the insulator, this is insulator. Inside the insulator is the core of the wire. Okay, inside the insulator is the core of the wire where it carries the negatively charged electron. And remember, when we have an electron, the charge is negative. Therefore, the electric field will be inward. Inward. The electric field will be inward because a current-carrying wire, it carries moving electrons. Okay. Macam mana nak tahu, macam nak ingat kalau negatif ni medan dia masuk, kamu bayangkanlah ini muka kamu, imagine that this is your face. You are trying to absorb so many input, so many knowledge from five different different subjects. Okay, you are trying to absorb the knowledge from five different subjects. And this is what happened to your face. You will have a flat face like this. You just need to put two eyes over here. Muka flat macam ni sebab kamu kena belajar banyak benda dalam satu masa lima. Ingat tu je. Flat face, ilmu masuk. Okay. Deviant teaching pula. Okay. Now, electric flux. To explain the electric field lines that come up from a current carrying wire can be imagined as easy as the picture shown on the left. So the electric flux is the total electric field. First definition, electric flux is the total electric field lines through area of the wire's insulator. Total electric field line passing through area of the wire's insulator. Ada bunyi pula.
Hello. Waalaikumsalam. Sudah okay. Thank you, bros. Salam.
Yay, telefon dah berfungsi. Alright. So the electric flux, electric flux, total electric field passing through an area. But which electric field? Which electric field can be considered as the flux? This is the definition. So the electric flux, we need to consider the electric field lines that are perpendicular to the area only, perpendicular. Perpendicular, for example, if we have this area, let's say we have small pieces, we zoom in into one area of the insulator and this is the surface of the insulator. Kalau kita ambil zoom dekat satu bahagian, and it happens to be that the electric field lines are in that directions, and the electric field line are not exactly perpendicular to the area. So this is not the electric flux, this is electric field, because it is not perpendicular. So the electric field, we could calculate the component of X and Y. How to calculate component X and Y? If we have theta over here, we could calculate the components. We could resolve it into component. So this is the component which is perpendicular to the area. Dia 90 darjah ni, yang dotted line. Dotted lines is exactly 90 degrees to the surface of the insulator. So how are we going to calculate them? How are we going to transform the electric field into electric flux? The knowledge you have learned before, it's not a new knowledge. It's a concept of vector. Again, so the Gauss law. The Gauss law stated that, the Gauss law states that the total electric flux through any closed surface is equal to the total charge inside divided by the epsilon naught permittivity of free space. How easy a charged particles could move within that space. That is the permittivity of free space. So the total electric flux, the total electric flux adalah total charge inside divided by epsilon naught. Total charge inside that area Okay, forget about the left term for a while. Lupakan term yang sebelah kiri sekejap eh. The total electric flux. Okay, let me change my... Eh? Asal colour ni? Colour ni tak sedap. Colour ni sedap. Ah, this is the symbol of electric flux. Ha. So the total electric flux through any closed surface is equal to the total charge inside the area divided by the permittivity of free space. Permittivity of free space is a constant. You could use your calculator. Which constant? It's 32. Number 13. Refer to the backside of your calculator. Look at the calculator. Look at the constant list. It is number 32. Okay, it's number 32. So, click constant. Click 32. You will get the value of permittivity free space is 8.854 times 10 to the power of negative 12 coulomb square divided by newton meter square. This is the value of epsilon naught. And how about this one, this term? So, the electric flux, the total electric flux also could be calculated by calculating the, what is this? This is the, the electric field perpendicular to the area. This is electric field perpendicular to the area. Not just any electric field, but the electric field perpendicular to the area. We need to calculate using the formula sine or cos, depending on the cases lah, which we will discuss in the example after this. If the question gives you only E, so you cannot use this E inside this equation. You cannot, because this equation is not E. It is E perpendicular to the area. Which area? This is the area. So we need to calculate the area that we are focusing on. If we know the area, if we manage to calculate this E perpendicular to the area, we could get the electric flux. You know what I mean? Okay, we have discussed the permittivity of free space. We look at example, this is not example one. Okay, now. So, this is the formula. The total electric flux equals to the E, which is perpendicular to the area. Susah tengok gambar kan? Saya tunjuk lagi gambar. Times A. A is the area of the insulator. So, equals to EA cos theta. How do we find E perpendicular to the area? It is E cos theta. E perpendicular to the area is E cos theta. This is the formula. And A adalah rumus luas permukaan insulator lah. Kalau dia circle, guna rumus circle. Kalau dia cube, guna rumus cube dan sebagainya. So let's say we have current carrying wire. Okay, ini keratan, bukan keratan rentas. Kalau wire tu macam ni, kita potong ke bawah macam ni. Kita akan nampak, we have the insulator over here and we have the wire over here. Let's say the electric field inside the wire is like this. It is not perpendicular. Kalau perpendicular, dia ke sana kan? Okay. Ni kalau perpendicular, dia ke sana. Ni perpendicular. Okay. Now, the electric field is not perpendicular to the area of the surface of insulator. Okay. Now, consider. Simplify the diagram. Consider one electric field like that. Okay. And this is the electric flux. Okay, this is the electric flux. The electric field that is perpendicular to the surface of the insulator. This is electric field. This is the electric flux. Okay, this is theta. So we redraw the diagram. We have E, we have perpendicular E, we have theta. So, using the formula cos theta, cos adalah persebelahan per hypotenuse. E perpendicular divided by E. So, that is why to calculate perpendicular to the surface, we use E cos theta. This is the origin of this equation. E perpendicular equals to E cos theta. Yang ni A. Ini pun A. Okay. Kalau laju sangat, beritahu eh. Saya slowkan sikit. So, the total electric flux through the surface of insulator could be defined as, okay, this is total electric flux, E perpendicular times A. So, E perpendicular, we use E cos theta. So, therefore, the final formula is this one. Harap-harap ingatlah. Eh? So, kita dah belajar tiga rumus. We have learned three formulas. First, the F, the electric force, electrostatic force. F equals to K times modulus Q1 times modulus Q2 divided by R12 square. Second formula is the electric field. The strength of the electrostatic force surrounding the charge. E equals to K times Q modulus, the charge, divided by the distance between the charge and the test charge. And this will be the third formula that you are learning today. Okay, the total electric flux equals to E cos theta times A. E cos theta is the electric flux or electric field perpendicular to the surface of the insulator. Harap-harap ingatlah. Okay. Now, example 11. Calculate the electric field flux. Calculate the electric flux. I think we should stop at 150. Eh? So we still have 21 minutes left. Calculate the electric flux through the rectangle shown in the figure. We have a rectangle over here. The rectangle is 10 centimeter by 20 centimeter. The electric field is uniform at 20 Newton per coulomb. And the angle is 30 degrees. Aha. So calculate the electric flux. Okay, direct application of this equation. Okay, electric field flux, electric flux equals to EA cos theta. E is given 200 Newton per coulomb. It is uniform. Uniform. How about A? A, this is rectangle. So, it's 20 by 10. 0.1 meter times 0.2 meter. Cos theta, we have the angle given. Finally, we will get the answer. It's 3.5 Newton meter square per coulomb. Just like that. Okay, how about this one? A uniform electric field of magnitude 5.8 times 10 to the power of 2 Newton per coulomb passes through a circle of radius 13 centimeter. Okay, what is the electric flux through the circle when its face is perpendicular to the electric, perpendicular to field line? This is when the electric flux is perpendicular, when the electric field is perpendicular to the line, to the field line. Restate the question A. What is the electric flux through the circle when the face is perpendicular to the field line? B, when it makes 45 degrees to the field line. E, 45 degrees. The angle sini 45. And how about parallel to the field line? Do we have any value for C? Can somebody answer me? Yes, zero. Thank you, Mael. C will be zero. Why? Sekejap lagi tunjuk. Why? Remember the formula. Okay. So we have for question A, it's already easy. Okay. Remember the formula for electric flux, it's EA cos theta, right? For question A, the field line is already perpendicular to the surface. the theta is zero. Remember, the theta that we are measuring, not the theta between the electric field line and the surface. If we measure that theta, the theta will be 90. And that 90 degrees cannot be used inside the formula. The theta that we are measuring is this theta. Okay, the angle between the perpendicular electric flux with the original electric field. This is the theta. The theta is not the angle between the electric field or the electric flux with the surface. This is theta. Don't forget. Jangan silap theta ni yang mana. Okay. So for example, this one. This electric flux already exactly perpendicular to the surface, and therefore theta is zero. Whenever theta is zero, cos theta equals to one. So we have E. This is E. This is A. A, the area of a circle, pi r square. Cos theta. We have another one, cos theta over here. But theta is zero, so cos theta is one. So we got 30.8 newton meter square per coulomb. And how about this one? This time the theta is not zero. This time the theta is 45 degrees, already mentioned over here. 45 degrees. We have 45 degrees over here. So this is E, this is A, this is cos theta. You got that one. How about this one? The theta now is 90 degrees. Pak ni. The theta is already 90 degrees. This is the what? The supposedly perpendicular electric field line, but now our electric field line is going over there. It makes 90 degrees with the surface. Therefore, cos 90 is, see, tekan juga tu, cos 90 is zero. That is why we got zero over here. Okay, tengok ni pula. Ini pun bukan pengiraan. Ini conceptual exercise. Yang ni tak payah tengok video lah. Kita bincang terus. Okay. Kita tukar kepada pen dulu. Alright. Which one of the following would cause a change in the electric flux through a circle lying in the XZ plane? Mari kita lukis XZ. Kita ada macam ni. Buruknya. Kita ada X. Kita ada Y. Kita ada Z. And the circle is lying in the XZ plane. Okay, we have a circle lying on the XZ plane. Okay, this XZ plane. Ni circle lah. Kan? Right. Tukar kali sekejap. Okay. Where the electric field is 10 Newton J. 10 Newton J means that the direction of the electric field is exactly on the y-axis. Remember IJK? Dia akan naik ke atas. Okay. 10 Newton. Apa ni? Which one of the following would cause change in electric flux through a circle? Tulis balik rumus electric flux. Electric flux. Boleh nampak ke tulisan kali biru ni? Equals to E A cos theta ataupun E perpendicular rap A. Kenapa naik atas? Naik atas macam mana tu maksudnya? Apa yang naik atas? 10. Sebab dia dalam ni. Komponen J. Dia dalam komponen J. Remember? Yelah, betul lah. Kalau X, dia komponen I. Kalau Y, komponen J. Kalau Z, dia komponen K. It's given from the question, 10 Newton J. Remember Syami? Alright, good question. Okay. So, if we change the magnitude of the field. Tukar merah balik. Okay. If we change the magnitude of the field. Change the magnitude of the field. What about if E is increased? Therefore, our total flux also will be increased. So, therefore, question A is, the answer is yes. Changing the size of the circle. Changing the size of the circle means that we change the area. If A is increased, our total flux also will be increased. Surface area. Surface area of the circle. That's why B is yes. Keeping the circle so that it is lying in the XY plane. We change the position of the circle. The circle now, so much to digest everything. saya nak slow down ke? Okay, now, this circle is on the XZ plane. What about if we tip this circle, we relocate it to the XY plane. XY plane means kat sini. Kat sini XY plane. The electric field or the electric field is still going upward. Will it change the value? Now, what have we changed over here? Question C. When we tip the circle from XZ to XY, yes, we change the direction. Therefore, we change the theta. Theta change. Therefore, the total electric flux will be changed. That's why C is yes. How about D? All of the above, yes, of course. None of the above, no. Jawapan dia. Begitu. Dia tak suruh kira pun dalam slide ni. Right? Cost decrease when degree is increased. Yes. Right. Yang ni pun tak suruh kira soalan yang ni. Ni conceptual je. Conceptual ini penting. Sekejap. Kita tengok. Sebab betul juga macam cakap Hidayah tadi. Banyak sangat benda nak absorb kan? Tepu. Saya cuba tengok sekejap slide ni. Okay. Saya rasa kita boleh stop sampai dekat exercise. Bukan exercise. Sampai exercise 8 saja. Okay. Yang apa ni? Seterusnya, electric potential semua ni kita belajar pada next week lah kot. Bila test tarikh dia? Ingat tak? Bukan next week kan? 6 hari bulan 1. 6 hari bulan 1. Oh, next week. 6 hari bulan 1. 6 hari bulan 1.
9, sir.
Ha? 9. Sempat. Kalau gitu next week hari Senin saya boleh sempat habiskan hari Senin kalau kita stop pada exercise 8 pada hari ini. Alright, so 9 tu adalah hari Sabtu. Okay, boleh. Right. Quiz yang 6-1. Habis test bila? Boleh semak sekejap tak? 9. Okay, quiz 6 eh. Test tu final ke? Bukan. Almost had mini heart attack. Saya pun kena heart attack dah. Apa dah? Man. Test tu. Okay. Exam kita berapa hari bulan? Cukur. Bercukurlah Hidayah. Exercise 8 je kita discuss hari ni. Kita last exercise 8. Sian Hidayah, tepu lah tu. Garing lah otak dia. Aduh. Alright. Cukur tu level bersyukur paling pasrah dah. Dia bersyukur tu apa relief lah, tapi bila dah level paling pasrah syukur. Okay, exercise 8. Soalan last. A cube of side L. Okay, kita ada cube ni, dia punya side ni semuanya L. Ini soalan contoh soalan kebat tau. Tak ada bagi nombor, semuanya simbol dan huruf je. Ni contoh soalan kebat. Kebat level 1. Okay, a cube of L is placed in a uniform field E. Where is E? Is okay, pada positive X axis direction, positive X axis. Okay, maksudnya dia merentas ke daripada kiri ke kanan. Dia akan melalui cube ni. Okay, pada permukaan tertentu. So, what is the flux through each of its six faces? The cube has six faces, denoted as A1, A2 until A6. We need to analyze it one by one. Okay, sekejap eh. Tukar pen. Okay. Now, we look at the first surface. We have A1 over here. Ini A1. Macam mana nak back ni? Tak ada back. Lantak lah. Okay, this is A1. Is there any electric flux on the surface of A1? Is there any electric field coming through the A1? Tak ada kan? Maka tak ada. Okay. So the theta is 90. Because remember, always look at which one is theta. Tengok balik diagram kita, which one is theta? Which angle is considered as theta? So, the theta. Nampak ke tidak ni? Alah, tak nampak. Okay, we are expecting something apa perpendicular to the area like this, but it turns out to be our E is over here, mengalir ke sana. The theta is over here, so cos theta cos 90, therefore we got 0. Jap, macam ni saya nak back, tekan back, discard. Okay, so tekan balik. Okay, so dekat A1 There is no on the surface of A1, there is no electric field coming out from the A1. Tak ada langsung coming out. Bila tak ada langsung coming out, maksudnya zero lah. Cos 90 kenapa? Kerana we are expecting E in this direction. But turns out to be the E is over there. So theta is 90. Gitu. How about E2? E2 yang ni lah. Ini. Ini adalah itu ni ha, bukan itu. Okay, how about itu? Ada flux tak keluar? Yes, there is flux coming through the A2 surface. How about theta? Exactly perpendicular to the surface of A2, therefore theta is 0. Cos theta equals to E, we don't have the value, just put E. How about A? The area of A2, we could calculate L times L. L is given kat sini. L is given. L times L. That's why we got cos 0 equals to 1. E maintain E. A2 is L square. We have L square. Now, how about A3? The flux coming through the A3. A3 yang belakang ni. Okay. Now. This time, theta is not 0, but theta is 180. Why? Because we are considering the flux coming out from the insulator. But in A3, the flux is not coming out. The flux is coming in. See the difference? A2, theta is 0 because the flux is coming out from the A2. And this one, the flux is coming in. That's why the theta is 180 degrees. The theta, we, 180 darjah. Daripada garis yang ni, kita bawa, ukur sampai garis ke belakang. Yang ni. Theta is 180 degrees. Cos 180 equals to negative 1. So that is why we got negative EL square. A4, A5, A6, all of them are 0 because there is no flux or there is no electric field coming through them. So negative tu determine the direction. Yes, yes, smile. Yes. Correct. Coming to, coming in or coming out. Gitu. Coming in negative, coming out positive. Okay. Empat elemen, enam semua faham. Elemen tak ada flux pun yang keluar daripada dia. Enam pun tak ada flux yang keluar daripada dia. Enam belakang ni jadi kosong. Empat yang kat bawah ni pula pun tak ada flux yang melalui dia, kosong. So, what is the net flux through the cube? Net flux. Total up all the flux through the cube. Yang masuk dan yang keluar total, kita kira, oh, semuanya adalah zero. Sebab yang ni tadi positif, yang ni adalah negatif. So, zero. Cukup pada hari ini. Sebabnya semua dah berasap. 1.45 dah. Dekat 1.50 dah. Alright. Kalau gitu, we continue our lesson on next Monday. Do watch the videos for the solution of the exercises. Try to do the exercises on your own. So we meet again next week, yeah? Alright, guys. Okay. Thank you. That's all for today. Class dismissed. Right.
Thank you, Doctor.
Welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. Welcome. Sempat tak nak makan? Nak pergi kelas yang seterusnya ni. Welcome.
Thank you, sir.
You're welcome.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. Oh, suara ganas. Oh, thank you, sir.
Demam, demam.
Ya, demam. Aduh, patut dah tak ceria ni. Mana kita nak stop? Okay, welcome. Kita nak stopkan recording ni. Sama-sama. Hang. Stop recording, guys. Stop recording.